Good morning, saints.
Good morning.
This is the day that God has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it.
Amen.
The Sabbath is approaching, and I'm excited about it. This song is called Written in Red. His love on a hillside so long, long ago. For you and for me, Jesus died, and love's greatest story. Thank you.
we begin with a word of prayer?
Yes.
Heavenly Father, we come boldly before your throne of grace this morning, petitioning for your grace, your mercy, your love, your peace, your guidance, your holy angels, your Holy Spirit. Father, I pray that you will fill us with your Spirit, that you will lead us, that you will guide us. And as we open up your word, especially, Lord, I pray that you will touch my lips with a coal from off your altar, that I may present your thoughts here today through my words and my tone of voice and my body language. And I pray that those watching and listening will see and hear your thoughts and not mine.
Amen.
Hide me behind Christ. Amen. This I ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
I want to look at the dual atonement. But I want to try to make this short, sweet, and simple. As simple as absolutely possible. I want this to be so simple that a child can understand it. So if I don't think I will oversimplify it, but realize that it's a lot deeper also than what I'm going to go into. Now, I remember, I think it was about 3 years ago at camp meeting, Elder Stump asked some people to review a quote or a statement and then say whether it was true or false about the dual atonement. And I was really surprised at who answered true and who answered false and how many people said they didn't know. This is something that we need to understand, and I think there have been some really powerful presentations about the dual atonement so far. So I think that maybe more of us will get the right answer this time because I'm going to do the same thing. I'm going to share two quotes, but I don't want you to answer audibly. Okay? I don't want you to answer audibly. But I'm going to ask you, is this statement true or is it false? Just answer it in your mind. But I want you to ponder it. Look at the statement and think about it. And see in your mind if it is true or not. Here's the first one. This sacrifice, referring to Calvary, was completely efficacious. It provided complete atonement for all mankind. So I want you to think about that. Is this statement true or is it false? I will tell you where it came from here in a minute because I don't want you to judge whether it's true or false based upon where it came from. So here's another statement. Jesus, our surety, entered the holy places and appeared in the presence of God for us. But it was not with the hope of obtaining something for us that at that time or at some future time. No, he had already obtained it for us on the cross. Now that one's a little more blatant. But still may be confusing to many people. In fact, there's the locations. And they're not right or wrong because of the location. But as soon as you see where they're from, so those two statements, the first one came from Questions on Doctrine, page 357. And the second one came from Questions on Doctrine, page 381. Now, just because it came from Questions on Doctrine doesn't make it wrong, but it doesn't make it right.
And it does take some of the surprise out of it.
It does take some of the surprise out of it, yes. So as soon as you find where it came from, you're automatically going to go up on guard. But friends, I want to tell you, we need to be able to see these things for what they are, even not knowing where they came from.
Amen.
So, in other words, if I'm up here teaching error, you need to know that I'm teaching error.
Mm-hmm.
You don't need to judge it because of who I am. You need to judge it based on, is it true or not?
Right.
You need to judge it based upon the Word of God.
Amen.
Not take it for where it came from. I want to read another statement. This comes from Barnhouse. And it was from, Are Seventh-day Adventist Christians, is what it was entitled in the Eternity magazine, September 1956. Just in case those two earlier statements weren't clear enough, Barnhouse makes it exceptionally clear. He says further, they, and he's referring to the Adventist leaders that they had met with, do not believe. Okay, so they do not believe the statement that he's about to make. As some of their earlier teachers, who would the earlier teachers be? The pioneers. Jan Loughborough, Jan Andrews, James White, Uriah Smith, J.H. Wagner. I mean, we could go on, right? So he's saying that the people that he just met with didn't agree with the pioneers. On what teaching? He says that Jesus' atoning work was not completed on the cross. So the pioneers taught that it was not complete at the cross. Now the sacrifice was, but the atonement was not. And so that can confuse people. Was the sacrifice complete? Yes, the sacrifice was complete on the cross. But the atonement itself, the two atonements, the atonement work was not complete at the cross. He says, but instead that he was still carrying on a second ministration, ministering work since 1844. So this is what the pioneers taught. But he says, this idea is also totally repudiated. Not just partially repudiated, but totally repudiated.
And this is 1956.
Yeah. This is about 1956, yes. Here's another statement from Questions on Doctrine. When, therefore, one hears an Adventist say or reads an Adventist literature, even in the writings of Ellen G. White. So not only is he throwing the pioneers under the bus, but now he's throwing Ellen White herself, or her writings, not her, but her writings under the bus.
Yes.
That Christ is making atonement now, it should be understood. Uh-oh. Mm-hmm. Now we've got a redefinition. Brother Thomas and I were listening to watching a video about a year ago, and the speaker was constantly saying, well, it should be understood. Or he would give a definition and then he would redefine. And every time Thomas would say, uh-oh, here comes a redefinition. So it should be understood. Here comes a redefinition. That we mean simply that Christ is now making application of the benefits of the sacrificial atonement he made on the cross. You see, friends, what this is a single atonement. There was a single atonement at the cross, and he's not doing a work of atonement now. All he is doing is applying that single atonement now. Well, I'm sorry. But this is justification only. That's what this is all about. That is problematic, and we're going to read some statements at the end showing that we need to understand this as a people. Open up your Bibles, if you will, with me to Leviticus chapter 4 and verse 20. Leviticus chapter 4 and verse 20. And we're going to look at something from a sin offering. Leviticus chapter 4 and verse 20. And the Word of God says, and he shall do with the bullock as he did with the bullock for a sin offering. So shall he do with this. And the priest shall make a what?
Atonement.
An atonement for them. And it shall be what?
Forgiven
them. So this atonement is dealing with forgiveness. This atonement is dealing with forgiveness. I want that to drive home. This is where forgiveness takes place. This is justification. Brothers and sisters, this is the cross. This is in the outer court, as we heard some presentations earlier referring to the outer court. This is where the cross is. I have two siblings. My brother is 8 years older, and my sister is 7 years older. So I don't remember all of the squabbles that they got into, because there were a lot of squabbles where I was too young to remember. But I do remember a squabble. Well, I don't remember the squabble, but I remember the thing that really stuck out to me. My brother was probably somewhere around 12, 13, I'm guessing. And they'd gotten into some squabble about something. I don't remember what the squabble was. What I do remember very clearly is that my brother wasn't happy with the results. Now, I don't know if my parents got involved and that's why he wasn't happy with the results, or he just didn't feel that my sister got enough punishment, or I don't know. But what I do remember is that my brother was very ingenuitive at revenge. Very, very ingenuitive. And in this particular instance, he mulled it over and he thought about how he was going to get back at my sister, whose name is Evie. And he came up with an idea, honestly, I never would have come up with. He got a red can of spray paint, went out to the house, on the side of the house, and he spray painted on the house, Evie is beautiful. And so when my parents came out, they look at the house and here's this spray painted house, their house, that says Evie is beautiful. Well, who are you going to assume said that? So out they march my sister and my brother. And my dad's like, Evie, did you do this? Matthew, did you do this? Because I can tell you there was going to be some judgment handed down on this issue. And so they asked, Evie, did she do it? And she said, no, it must have been Matthew. And they're like, why would Matthew write Evie is beautiful on the side of the house, especially after you guys just had a quarrel? Well, I don't know, but I didn't do it. Well, see, my sister had a history. She could be caught red-handed and she would still deny it. I didn't do it. In fact, when my dad would whip her, she was so stubborn. He would whip her and she would say, didn't hurt. And so what is he gonna do? He's gonna whip her harder next time. Whack! Didn't hurt. He'd wind up and he'd whack her the third time with his belt. Tears are rolling down her face. I can remember this very distinctly. Tears are rolling down her face and she's standing there in defiance. Didn't hurt. And I'm like, just learn. As soon as the belt was raised, I was screaming bloody murder. And then it was a tap. You just learn. But she was known for her outright defiance. So are they going to believe that my brother did it? No. Why would he write Evie is beautiful? Well, had they thought it through, it was really an ingenious idea. Actually, my brother didn't fess up to this until about 5 years ago. He was too scared. But let's say that Evie did write that on the side of the house. And let's say that when my parents came out and they happened to see it, they marched her out there and they said, Evie, did you write this? And she says, yes, I did. I'm sorry. And my parents say, okay, you're forgiven. Now, is everything all hunky-dory? Is everything all peachy now?
No.
No, there's still a problem, isn't there? It's not all back to normal. There's still red spray paint on the side of the house, isn't there? She may have been forgiven, but brothers and sisters, her sin was still marring her father's house. You can't be at one ment with God just because you're forgiven if your sins are still marring your father's house. You see, anytime the family comes in or goes out, there's going to be that huge sin right there. Anytime the neighbors look over, there's going to be that great big sin in red spray paint on our Father's house. We can't be truly at one with God just because we're forgiven. We need to be at one with God when our sins are wiped off our Father's house. So there is an atoning work in forgiveness, yes. But there is also an atoning work in cleansing. And they both need to be done in order for there to be complete at-one-ment with God. Our record of our sins must be cleansed. Let's turn to Leviticus chapter 16 and verse 19. Just a few pages over. Leviticus 16, 19. Does anybody know what this chapter is about? Day of Atonement. And so we're going to see something, what it says in verse 19, and we're going to look for a particular word. See if you can catch it. Leviticus chapter 16 and verse 19. And he shall sprinkle of the blood upon it with his finger seven times and cleanse it, and what?
Hallow it,
or make it holy, from the uncleanness of the children of Israel. Did you see the difference between this and Leviticus 4:20? One was forgiveness, and this one is dealing with what?
Cleansing.
Do you see the difference? Are they the same thing? No, they are not. This is where cleansing takes place on the Day of Atonement. Friends, this is also what you would call sanctification, if you will. This is not the cross. This is Jesus' heavenly ministerial work that is going on today. Do you see the differences? Was everything complete at the cross? No.
Not everything.
Not everything. The sacrifice was complete.
Yes.
But not everything was complete at the cross. We'll look at a couple of quotes and we'll close. Patriarchs and Prophets, page 357, paragraph 5. The blood of Christ, while it was to release the penitent sinner from the condemnation of the law, was not to what?
Cancel
the sin. Do you want your sins canceled?
Yes.
I know I do. I'm very thankful above what I could possibly explain to be forgiven, but I don't want to see my sin marring my Father's house. I want things to be cleansed. So it was not to cancel the sin. It would stand on record in the sanctuary until the final atonement. Manuscript 21, 1895. Today, he, that's Christ, is making an atonement for us before the Father.
Amen.
On the cross?
No.
Today, is it an application?
Yes.
It's an atonement.
It's the atonement itself.
Yeah. Yes.
It's a second atonement.
Yeah.
So it's not just an application. You could look at it in a sense, but...
It says an atonement.
So, in other words, as L.E. Froom said, he's just making application of the atonement. This isn't an application of the first.
No, right.
This is an atonement itself. If any man sin, yes, that's thus the duel. If any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. Mm-hmm. Praise the Lord. Because he's the one that's going to cleanse that. Now, that example I gave earlier about my sister and my brother, ultimately, what it should have been to be a perfect example is when my parents asked if my sister did it and she said yes, my brother would have stepped up and said, I will take the punishment. Mm-hmm. And then I will take the soap and water and clean the house.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And my sister would have done none of that. That would have been the perfect example. Testimonies, Volume 5, Testimonies to the Church, Volume 5, page 575. All need to become? How many is all? Now, that question was asked yesterday. What does all mean? It means all, doesn't it? Does that mean us?
Yes.
Absolutely. That means us. So we need to become more intelligent in regard to the work of the atonement. Which atonement? The atonement which is going on in the sanctuary above.
Amen.
Not disregarding the atonement on the cross, but the context here is the atonement that is going on today. When this grand truth is seen and understood, those who hold it will work in harmony with Christ. You want to work in harmony with Christ?
Yes.
Then that means we need to understand the dual atonement. Those who hold it will work in harmony with Christ to prepare a people to stand in the great day of God. Do you want to be prepared yourself?
Yes.
Then that means we need to understand the dual atonement. And their efforts will be what?
Successful.
This is a promise. Do you want to claim that promise?
Yes.
Amen.
Then we need to understand the dual atonement. Does that make sense?
Amen.
Now, while our high priest is making this great controversy, page 623. Now, while our high priest is making the atonement for us, we should seek to become perfect in Christ. Is that a dirty word?
No.
No. That is
one
of the most beautiful words there is, because it is a blessed promise. Friends, I don't want to stay in my sin. I want to be lifted out of it and cleansed. Who wants to swim in that quagmire? How can you dance up and down and say, "Yay, I'm forgiven," and go swimming in this stuff? That baffles me. That's what gave me the burdens to start with. I don't want to keep carrying those. We should seek to become perfect in Christ. Not even by a thought could our Savior be brought to yield to temptation. Now there's a high calling. He had kept his Father's commandments, and there was no sin in him that Satan could use to his advantage. This is the condition which those must be found who shall stand in the time of trouble. That's a sobering thought. Do we have a long ways to go?
Yep.
I have a long ways to go, but I don't have a long time to do it.
Oh.
It is in this life that we are to separate sin from us through faith in the atoning blood of Christ. Our precious Savior invites us to join ourselves to Him, to unite our weakness to His strength, our ignorance to His wisdom, our unworthiness to His merits. I'm going to read Testimonies, volume 5, page 355 and 353 and 354 as my closing appeal. So I want you to think about this. I want you to think, am I willing to accept this? As I read this, from this hour, resolve to be the Lord's. Are you willing to covenant with God on what is about to be said? Doing your whole duty, trusting implicitly in the great atonement. Do this, and you will have nothing to fear. Brothers and sisters, if we don't understand the atonement, then we can't trust implicitly in this, and we will fear. The remainder of your life journey will be tranquil and happy. Now, she's not saying you won't walk through the fiery furnace. She's saying you will walk through that fiery furnace with Jesus.
Amen.
There's a difference. And with Jesus by your side, you can walk through it, and the only thing that's going to be burned away are your bonds that held you. And you will secure to yourself that life which shall continue as long as God shall live. Are you willing to say, "Lord, this is what I want"? Show of hands.
Yes.
Amen.
Let us kneel in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come before your throne of grace. But we come before your throne of grace boldly because of what Jesus has done.
Amen.
And Father, we petition a greater understanding on this topic. Amen. Father, I don't understand this well enough. I want to understand this more. I pray that you will give me a greater understanding as I read through your word. Father, as we read through your word, day in and day out, I pray that you will help us to see the work of Christ, not only on the cross, but today in the Day of Atonement. Lord, I pray that you will help us to be a sober people that are the people of the book, not Laodicea, but Philadelphia, that we will have that first love. I pray that we will be prepared to stand without fear, knowing that Jesus is by our side.
Amen.
And Lord, I pray that you help us. Send angels that excel in strength to watch over and protect us, to lead us and guide us. This I ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.